seat. Notified by the fire marshal that we may be somewhat over the occupancy for this room, but I don't think it's officially been rated, so we're going to proceed on. I think some people are here for the first order of business on the Family Justice Center. At that point in time, they may leave the room and others can have a seat. But before we get started with the official agenda, I'd like to ask Vice Chairman Engel to give our invocation.
I'd like to call on David Carter, who is the Associate Pastor of Baptist Temple, for invocation. Thank you.
Hey, we pray. Lord, we thank you that we live in the great states, the United States of America. We thank you for the brave men and women that fight for our freedom, the very freedom that we will experience and practice here tonight. For each person that's here, we're thankful as they show concern for this community. We ask that you grant us much wisdom, as many decisions will be made here tonight for people in this community and regarding community decisions that will long proceed and go before us. We ask that you give us that wisdom tonight. Look after us, watch over each and every one of us as we travel to our respective places when we leave here. We thank you for sending your son to die on the cross for us. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. The items that are on the agenda tonight are not a public hearing. After each presentation, if the commissioners have any comments, that's all that's scheduled for this evening. There is a public comment section in the very beginning of our agenda, which I'm going to open up in just a moment. And people should have signed this register here to speak. So we'll begin with the public comment section at this time. The first person who has signed up is George Hansen.
Here was saying that perhaps we did not need to sign up as well. Is that correct?
No, it's you need to register for the public comment session, but we'll open it up.
Okay. Thank you. I was just clarifying that for those who are asking. Good evening.
Before anyone, we timed it. We'd like for you to keep your comments to 3 minutes or less, if you would.
Absolutely. Good evening, commissioners. My name is Jared Hansen. I'm pastor of Fairview United Methodist Church, a church nestled between two old mill villages in the northwest part of Alamance County. I thank you for your time this evening to hear many concerned voices. I do not envy or desire your task tonight or any of the times you dutifully serve the public good. The complexity of issues before this board is great, and it is my hope that you are able to rightfully discern a new direction for Alamance County regarding 287G of the Federal Immigration and Customs Enforcement. The number and diversity of people who are extremely bothered by the facts and the perception of the implementation of 287G is vast and quickly gathering momentum nationally and locally. If those in the room from Alamance County who would consider also their voices of concern for 287G, please acknowledge yourselves to the board by standing up or raising your hand. Thank you, residents of Alamance County who are concerned. And those, all those on the wall who are standing automatically got counted. I am honored to speak tonight to my elected officials in a public meeting for the first time. It is my hope that I use my time to speak not only for myself as a voting resident of Alamance County, but also for those who live in our county and communities who are not able to speak on their own behalf tonight because of fear and hopelessness. Our concern is that the implementation, if not the very nature of this program itself, creates undue fear, anxiety, and distress that will create greater divisions in our communities, as my newfound friends will soon enumerate and elaborate. We appeal you, commissioners, to reevaluate the humanitarian, the moral, and spiritual implications of programs like 287G. The public is quickly losing confidence in some of our elected officials and of our local administration. Even those who believe differently in faith than I do are aware of the humanitarian issues unfolding before us in the face of immigration in the U.S. The separation of families, public humiliation, and an uncertain and frightening future for our neighbors are not the marks of the America we desire. Higher values than exclusion will be the redemption of these practices. Martin Luther King Jr. has famously quoted St. Augustine, saying that an unjust law is no law at all. And our country has a scarred history of legal laws that are now correctly seen as unfair, unjust, and utterly cruel. It is our hope that this law too soon will become only a shamed relic of our past. More particularly tonight, we are concerned with the unjust enforcement of the law, where minor infractions of order explode into life and death situations, ripping families apart, where the most vulnerable of our society are preyed upon, and at what cost, for what purpose, from what fear. Perhaps even this program is one more step to identification papers on demand, such practices having a notorious and heinous history. But as an evangelical Christian, and as we as people of faith in Jesus Christ, we have nothing to fear. No power or principality can separate us from Christ's love, which compels us to welcome the stranger. If you permit me, I'll read from the Gospel of Matthew. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory, and the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me." His own disciple said, "When? Where?" And Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these, you did it unto me." And then he said to those on his left hand, "You that are accursed, depart from me." Salvation comes to those who welcome the stranger. To those who hinder the stranger, may God have mercy. The Holy Scriptures of the Hebrew Bible, the Old Testament, and the New Testament, whose heart is the gospel of Jesus Christ, and the nature of God itself make demands on human communities, not just individual souls. We are commanded to welcome, aid, shelter, feed, not hinder the traveler, the sojourner, the immigrant, for their journey has already been hard enough. Our God compels us to compassion for those in need of mercy. For the immigrant story is our story. We are all on a journey, all in need of compassion and mercy. And I dare say that the law, the true law, God's law, is love, mercy, and grace through Jesus Christ. Not recrimination, detention, disdain, exclusion, and deportation. As the vigil that preceded this meeting took place, I had the opportunity to listen to other voices on the street. Voices that mocked our gathering and relished in a hatred for those immigrants among us who don't have proper documentation. And my heart reached and yearned for her a life free from the slavery of hate. Yearned for her a life freed from the lessons of Scripture. I end my introduction to the following speakers with the words from Leviticus. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel, and say to them, 'You shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy.' When an alien resides with you in your land, you shall not oppress the alien. The alien who resides with you shall be to you as the citizen among you. You shall love the alien as yourself, for you are aliens in the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God." Thank you for your time.
Okay, thank you. Why is there a knee house?
Good evening. I want to thank the commissioners for having all of us here. And I'm so happy to see so many friends, old friends and new friends, and friendly faces. Sheriff, I guess that my speech is going to be like something related to what's been said and what's been done. The Sheriff's Department stated several times publicly, even to the press, and I can quote Times News 4/29/07, when Mr. Jones said that we are not here arresting people with no operator's license. And the sheriff kind of supported that, saying that we are not messing with any misdemeanor stuff. But the truth and the reality is that in practice, the opposite has been going on. And people have been arrested and incarcerated with minor crimes such as traffic infractions, including no operator's license and misdemeanors. And valued members of our community have been affected, or these crime victims have been deported, and children have been mistreated along the way. Mm-hmm. One important thing to stress is that the Sheriff's Department has not legally complied with the provisions of the Memorandum of Understanding, MOU, that they signed with the Immigration and Customs Enforcement, because there is still no 287G steering committee to provide oversight of the program as required by law in Section 13 of the MOU. And there is also no complaint mechanism in place as required by law under the MOU. And the next speaker is going to explain a little bit more about that. But had the Sheriff's Department implemented those procedures, he and his deputies might have received fuller guidance, which could have helped the county avoid the recent negative publicity. And I apologize for using a paper, because it is in English. Had it been in Spanish, I would be without a paper. So future events might place the county at risk of extensive litigations. All members of the community can assist law enforcement in keeping county residents safe. But a large segment of this community is now afraid to contact the law enforcement when they have witnessed or been victim of a crime because of the state of fear, instability, and mistrust in law enforcement that has been created. So we respectfully call on Alamance County Commissioners, you, sirs, and madam, the sheriff, and the Alamance law enforcement to fulfill their promises regarding the 287G program and stop targeting the Hispanic population at large and arresting valued members of our community. We respectfully call for an end to the expenditure of valued public resources on the incarceration and deportation of undocumented individuals with traffic infractions and minor offenses. And most important, we respectfully urge law enforcement officials to remember the humanity of all persons in our country, regardless of immigration status, and keep in mind that young and not so young American citizens are amongst the victims of this unfortunate process. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you once again for having us, all of us, here today. I'm here on behalf of the Spanish Latino community, and I'm here to speak for them because many of them are not here except for just a handful of people. And just as the previous speaker mentioned, we would like for the county commissioners to go back and look at the MOU and let the public know where and whom the steering committee are and what their job is going to be or what they have done. We will also look for the county commissioners to establish, along with the Sheriff Terry Johnson, a department of complaint for all of these county residents to go and complain, or just to fill out a paper and say what they like and what they don't like about 287G. 287G has been in place for quite some time, and many families American citizens' families have been torn apart because of what's been going on. I'm sure all of you look at the paper on Sunday morning. And so those two children on the front page waiting on their mother to be deported. What's going to happen to them? Who's going to care for them? Those are questions that possibly, maybe, could be or could be not that the MOU has established or hasn't. But that's all we want. Those Hispanic Latino community is not here today. Some of them are, and many of them are not. Let's keep in mind, and let me repeat this again, they are not reporting crimes or vandalism that has been happened to them because they are afraid of what's going to happen to me. If I report a crime, I am here undocumented. Will they come after me or my children because I don't have any paperwork or legality to be here? They are asking those questions. Many of them are being vandalized. Many of them are being assaulted, but they are not reporting the crimes. Many of them are questioned, whom can we go? What can we do? Should I go to the Centro La Comunidad? I don't know. Should I go somewhere else? Or who is going to listen to me? All we want, and we urge you to please go back to the EMOU and look it over and see if everything that is on that piece of paper has been established and agreed upon by all powers that be, because all we want is a county to be safe, not just for one group of people, but for everyone who's paying taxes, because our elected officials are sending or have sent forms of donation for their campaign. Many of these Hispanic Latinos have received those forms. Many of them have sent money to those campaigns. And they are questioning, should I keep on sending money to these elected officials, or should I ask for my money back when they deport me? I want my money back with interest. Is that going to be possible if I'm deported? I don't know. Please, ladies and gentlemen, go back to the EMOU and look it over. And if somewhere in there it says that people fishing without a license can go to jail and be deported, by all means. But let's not forget about those criminals who are actually doing the crimes out there, not driving without a license. Thank you.
Laura Rosell.
Good evening, commissioners. My name is Laura Rosell, and I live in Burlington. And like many members of the community, I was very upset when I heard about the recent occurrences in Alamance County involving the 287G program. In particular, I was concerned that children were suffering, with some stranded on the side of the highway for hours, another, a toddler, an American citizen, having his family broken apart and him left without his mother or father. Yesterday, yet another story, as the paper reported, on a baby left with a news reporter without food or diapers in the middle of the night while the child's mother was questioned. I'm a mom, a mother, a community member. I'm also a professor of political science at Elon. And after recent events, I realized I didn't really know as much as I should about how the program is implemented. And I don't think I'm alone. The public and the commissioners should know much more about this program. And I don't have to tell any of you sitting up there about the implementation of public policy. You do this. I don't have to tell you especially about new and untried programs and how they sometimes can have unintended consequences and can cause additional and serious problems. So tonight I wanted just to briefly focus on the implementation of the 287G program in hopes that you would look at it, take another look at it, and address the concerns of the community. First, my understanding is that the sheriff told the county commissioners and the public that only serious and violent felons would be the focus of the implementation of this program. Others have spoken about the quotations from the sheriff in the newspaper. Yet the data show that in 2007, about a quarter of all arrests of those people put into removal proceedings were for traffic violations, and less than 10% were arrested for felonies. This doesn't seem to fit with what the sheriff told the public or the commissioners about what would happen. And second, I too have questions about whether Alamance County is in compliance with the Memorandum of Understanding or this MOU, which sets out the terms for the implementation of 287G. One example of its content is the requirement of this complaint mechanism. The complaint mechanism is supposed to be publicized in English and other languages as appropriate, quote, in order to ensure that individuals are aware of the availability of such procedures, unquote. I don't believe this has been done. And if there is no publicized complaint procedure, how can the public complain about perceived problems? In addition, the MOU, I understand, requires the establishment of a steering committee. This committee is charged with the review and assessment of the immigration enforcement activities associated with this program. I'm not sure if there is a steering committee. If there is, I would call for its members to be publicly identified, its meetings to be publicized, and its findings to be disseminated to the public. And if there's not a steering committee, we need to have one, because it's so required in the MOU. And there are many people in the community who would be interested in serving on this committee. If we had a well-functioning steering committee, we might be able to avoid some of the problems we now see with the implementation of the program. We might be able to find out when ICE is called and when they are not. We might develop better and more humane procedures for dealing with children. We might find ways to better handle Spanish language interpretation issues. And you, the county commissioners, would have some place to go for information about the enforcement of 287G and would be able to answer the public's questions. In conclusion, I just wanted to say that oversight and transparency improve the implementation of public policy and strengthen democracy. And perhaps this would help change the belief that many people have that the implementation of the 287G program is out of control. And perhaps this would help repair the damage that has been done to the image of Alamance County. Thank you.
Thank you. Anna Gill.
I'm actually choosing this time not to speak at the bar as I'll express everything I had to say. Thank you.
David Stark.
I, too, at this time, choose not to speak. Laura Roselle and previous echoed my sentiments.
Peter Childress. Childress?
Childress, yeah. Hi, good evening. Thank you. I, too, have some questions about 287G, and I need some more information. All of my information so far has been from articles in the Alamance News, so I am looking for some more information tonight. I hope this is going to be within the 3 minutes. I'll try. I wrote it down. But I'm going to start by giving you a quote from an article by David Griswold, and he's the director of the Center for Trade Policy Studies at the Cato Institute, and that's not your typical liberal think tank. In that article, he states, and I quote, "Any immigration reform worthy of the name must reflect the underlying reality that the American economy continues to create hundreds of thousands of new jobs each year for low-skilled workers. Those jobs are being created in retail stores, food preparation, cleaning and janitorial services, for retail salespersons, agriculture, construction, landscaping, and groundskeeping. Meanwhile, the supply of Americans willing and happy to fill those same jobs continues to shrink. We're getting older and more educated as a nation. The median age of an American in the workforce will reach 41.6 by 2012. The highest in American history. And the share of adult native-born Americans in the workforce without a high school diploma, the very workers who are most likely to fill those jobs, has dropped from more than 50% in the early 60s to below 10% today. Where are the lines of Americans wanting to pick lettuce all day under a hot sun or scrub floors and toilets all night at discount stores? That's honorable work, and there just aren't enough of us anymore to fill the jobs being created. Illegal immigration continues to grow because their immigration law has no legal channel for a peaceful, hardworking immigrant from Mexico or another country to enter the United States legally to fill those jobs, even temporarily. The result is large-scale illegal immigration." And that's the end of the quote. Now, I believe a country needs to control its borders, and I also want those who commit crimes against members of this community prosecuted. But how and why we do that is a large part of this debate that I don't have time here to go into. I also don't have time to discuss the broader issues why immigrants from Mexico need to come to this country. But let's remember, illegal immigrants largely come to our community to work. They come here to support themselves and their families. They can work here because U.S. citizens hire and pay them. hiring an illegal immigrant is also a crime. How many employers have been charged by the Sheriff's Department? The problems that illegal immigrants present to the community, such as healthcare and schooling, are symptoms of wider issues, such as a lack of a rational and cohesive policy on affordable healthcare, and lack of a school funding method that fairly pays for the cost of education. Illegal immigrants represent the symptoms of low wages that any low-wage citizen presents to this community. If these people were legal, they would still require health care, and their children would still need school. The same issues would exist, and large-scale jailing and deportation of illegal immigrants will not make the need to address these issues disappear. I also have questions as to the timing and intensity of the enforcement of 287. And I need to understand more as to why the Sheriff's Department and County Commissioners want this type of application of 287 now. It appears to me at this point that this push for enforcement came after the new county jail got its certificate of occupancy. Were we enforcing in 287G with the same intensity before the completion of the jail? Did the design and construction of the new jail give the county excess cell capacity? Are we using the availability of federal funds to house illegal immigrants as a method to help pay for the jail? If this is the case, then is this clouding our law enforcement and public policy judgment? Now, I don't know how many illegal immigrants in this community are involved in crimes other than the act of being here illegally. My observations tell me that Spanish-speaking members of this community commit very little crime. I don't know how many truly dangerous criminals the Sheriff's Department has apprehended because of the present enforcement of 287G in relation to the number of people checked for ID and arrested. I don't know how sheriff's officers handle a Spanish-speaking or looking person who has committed a misdemeanor and decide to investigate under 287G and avoid the appearance of incorrect profiling. What actions do the Sheriff's Department take when enforcing misdemeanors for Spanish people that are different for other community members? I believe that if the Sheriff's Department enforced the letter of all laws in this community with the same intensity as is now given 287G, there would be many angry citizens before the county commissioners. And I have some final points to consider. Illegal immigrants who are victims of crime and afraid to report this to the sheriff's office does not protect this community. Illegal immigrants who are afraid to come forward as a witness to crime does not protect this community. Illegal immigrants who have a communicable disease, such as tuberculosis, but are afraid to get treatment at the health department does not protect this community. Illegal immigrants who are afraid to take their children to the public health clinic does not protect this community. We need a broader discussion and understanding as to the justification of this type of application of 287G, and we need Washington to fix this problem, not our local communities.
Commissioners, thank you for this opportunity to speak tonight. My name is Janice McSherry, and I've lived in Graham since 1962 and consider it my duty to vote for our officials and support them once they are elected, regardless of whether I voted for them or not. We pay Sheriff Johnson and his staff to do their jobs. We have the right, since we live in a free country, to voice our opinions, whether they are doing a good or bad job. I would like to say that I do support Sheriff Johnson and his staff in upholding the laws of this land. Not only are they of this land, they're of this county and of the state. I do not believe that Sheriff Johnson or his staff is overstepping their bounds, doing their responsibility. I believe they have read and understand the laws and know what their jobs are, and they uphold the laws. While I understand people want to come to the U.S. to live and work and make a better life for themselves and their families, there is a right and a wrong way to do that. People who come through our customs and immigration offices do it the right way, and I, for one, welcome those people to come into the melting pot of our country. As an example, the Vietnamese, the British, the Montagnards, Chinese, Canadians, and other nationalities who get their E-1 visas, obtain legal social security numbers, pay taxes, and finally take the oath of office, oath of citizenship for the United States of America. Our law-abiding people who we welcome to our country. They contribute to the financial and social well-being of this nation. But people who break the laws and enter our country illegally, obtain illegal social security numbers, and commit other incidents are breaking the laws of our country and should be held accountable. The fact of the matter is there are laws that we all have to live by. Whether it is stealing, murder, rape, or whatever, we all make choices to either be a law-abiding citizen who do not break the laws or to be criminals who do break the laws. At the legal age of 18, we all become accountable for our choices and our actions. Each of us must live with these decisions we make from that point onward in our lives. If a small child is brought into this country and remains here for a number of years, as they approach their 18th birthday and know that they are not here legally, they should approach our officials, seek guidance and advice on how to remain in this country. This takes a very brave and a very responsible person to do that. If they make the choice to remain in this country illegally, then they must be prepared to live with their choice. Our tax dollars support the public services that are offered to the residents of our country. If someone who is not here legally receives services from these agencies that our tax dollars are going towards to support, then they are breaking the law. I believe that the employees that work for the public service agencies should be held to the same standards as the sheriff and any other agency that has rules and guidelines to follow, and that they should be good stewards and of our tax dollars. It is the tax dollars of the citizens of this country, state, and country that are paying to support these agencies. We were taught as children, and we have taught our children to be responsible. Each of us are held accountable for our choices. Shouldn't someone who is here illegally be held responsible for their choice as well? I believe we should be thankful for the conscientious people who do their jobs and uphold the laws of this nation. I personally have supported several people who have come to the United States as immigrants. I've worked with them, helped them establish residency, get their visas, L visas, E visas, and then worked towards taking their United States citizenship exam and passing that. Several of those families have become business owners, one in this community and one in another state. Part of their responsibility as a business owner is to employ United States citizens. And they also employ some of their own nationality. I think this is a commitment that we should all follow and show the growth for and the well-being to the United States that we should have respect for. Once again, I do support Sheriff Johnson, and I do support our men in uniform that take care of our community. Thank you.
I know some of you probably didn't realize that there was a sign-up sheet that you need to sign to speak. Knowing that, I'll go around the room if anybody feels like they need to address this topic or any other topic. It's not confined to any particular subject. So we'll start over here on my left. Is there anybody along the sidewall that would like to speak? In the back? Kenneth, are you standing?
Kenneth Evans, lived in Graham 65 years, paid taxes, and I think if you're illegal, you're illegal. If you come to North Carolina to have 4 or 5 kids, you're illegal. 2 kids in the newspaper, I think the mother and daddy, they were illegal, and so what you gonna do? We're stuck with it, but you know. The sheriff's department, fire departments, I support them all. They do a good job. And I think the American people, I told them 13 years ago, we were going to be run over by Latinos. And we are. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
anybody along the back road, standing along the back road, over here towards the door, I see a hand waving. Yes, ma'am.
Well, my name is Barbara Robertson. Thank you for letting me speak. I have not prepared anything, but I would like to say that listening to the different arguments, I think that the issue is much more complicated than any of us here are even beginning to understand. It's so complicated that it just doesn't seem like the federal government has much of an answer. They keep arguing back and forth, and I still don't see where we have come up with a good solution to the problem of immigration. I have been to Guatemala. I would like to report one of the most, a situation that left me in tears for days when I saw a lady trying to make it up the sidewalk. I was headed down the sidewalk. It was a steep hill. It was 7 o'clock in the morning. It was pouring rain. There were people everywhere walking and going to work, catching buses in the street. Nobody owns cars there. Everybody takes a bus. There's no money. If there is a truck or a car, the tires are walled. Back to this person. She's going up the street on a piece of cardboard. She has nothing below her hips, no legs. She's pulling herself up the sidewalk with her arms. She has her pocketbook hanging over her shoulder. It's dragging in the mud and the wet. This is what she has to get to where she's going. Her arms are very muscular, her hands are worn. This is how she gets around. This is poverty in Central America. It's poverty in Mexico. I think until you understand poverty in those conditions, you don't understand immigration here in the United States and why many people come here, why they're forced to. They have no food for their families. They don't have nothing to give their children. They don't have many children nowadays. The people I know stay with 2 children at the most. They know that they can't raise their children. They have no money. There's no money coming in. They get $2 a day, sometimes $2 a week for pay, sometimes if that. We don't understand poverty in the United States. We don't understand how difficult it is to cross the borders into the United States and become immigrants legally. How difficult it is to fall under the different programs that allow us in for language or for studies or for work visas and so forth. They just don't exist in the numbers that we want, and or that, not that I want, but that people need to survive, because they can't survive in these countries. And I don't think that we also understand very well the effects of our federal policies as far as the trade policies and what it's doing to some of these other countries. I know I don't understand them. I think this topic is way above us, but for us to treat the people that are within our communities humanly and in the way that we would like our own children, our own families to be treated is the bottom line. And if you commit a crime, certainly you need to be able to deal with that crime or pay for that crime in some way. I don't know if we can really justify illegality and being in this country as illegal in the same way we can many of the other things that people do in this nation. I know I'm not well spoken. I haven't thought out what I'm saying. I'm just speaking from the top of my head. But I want you to hear that there is a heart that goes out to people, and that's really where we should be thinking. We can't continue to treat people with a hard hand all the time and treat all people as if they are all here for the wrong that we would like to hope that we see. And excuse me for not being better spoken. Thank you.
Folks, I'm going to be brief. Break up. Born and raised in Alamance County, love. We got the greatest sheriff that this state has seen in a long time.
287G, I can lay down at night and go to sleep. Mr. Childers, and I'm not picking on him, I like the guy, said that the Hispanics and illegal immigrants come here and they do the menial jobs nobody else wants to do. I have people show up at my place wanting a job all the time. There ain't no cheap help out there, so you can forget that. It's not there. I have people come up demanding $15 an hour when I want to recruit, you know, show me some identification. They don't have it. So they're ready to turn around and walk on that driveway. There is no cheap help, so forget that, okay? Second of all, that man needs to be commended for what he's doing. He don't need all these people in here, you know, tearing it down and everything. There's been two home invasions on this road that I live on, and his men were right there, and they took care of everything. My wife can lay down at night. I'm here. She's at home. She's safe. She feels safe, thanks to Terry Johnson. So, you know, with that being said, I'm proud of you, buddy. I'm done.
Anybody else along the...
Yes.
Well, we've already had that set. This gentleman back here raised his hand first. Sir, come up. Ma'am.
Good evening. I'm an immigrant. I did not graduate from a North Carolina high school like that young library worker did. I did not say the Pledge of Allegiance to the American flag. I did not study American history. I studied German history. Yet, she is more a citizen of this country than I am, because I came at a time, 35 years ago, when it was easy. And let's face it, I am white, and I'm coming from a preferred country, so I had no obstacles. When people talking about taking responsibility, there is no way for anyone, for that young woman, to become, be a responsible citizen. There's no path. In 1996, the immigration law broke that path. Everyone who has to, wants to become, even have legal residency, not even a citizen, legal residency, has to leave the country to apply. Now, there are 3 to 10 year bars, depending how you came to the country. Then there are 15 to 20 year waiting periods because we are so backlogged with family applications that you literally have to wait for your whole child to grow up before you can hope to be reunited. So, I'm a mother. If I am separated from my child, and there is a line, a border, I will break every law in this country and any other country to be with my child. Because, first of all, I am human. And that, to me, is much greater law, to be a mother to my child, than any artificial border in the sand. Now, we are a nation of immigrants. Every wave of immigrants has faced the very same hateful rhetoric. They bring diseases, they are illegal, they break into house, they're all criminals. Actually, the crime rates for Americans is much higher than for, or the violent crime rate is much higher for Americans than it is for the Latino community. So, but I think the danger is much greater to us, to our democracy, to our freedom, to our sense of being decent people. When I look in the mirror, I want to see a good person looking back. And when I think of families being torn apart, the part that is good in me has to say no. There is a saying that says, much law, little justice. And it always seems that in times of hunting a certain part of the population, we hide behind the law. And our basest instincts then become almost virtuous. But when we look at it, I look at it from a mother's point of view. There is nothing good about tearing families apart. There's nothing good about orphaning children so they grow up in foster homes or raised by strangers. There's nothing good about the heartbreak that we cause when we keep husband and wife apart, parents and children, brothers and sisters. Now, we do need to uphold the law, but we need the law, a law that honors our heritage as a country of immigrants and our humanity. Thank you.
Okay, anybody on the seated section on my left here? Yes, ma'am.
Good evening. I just want to say thank you for the opportunity that I can speak to you. I wasn't going to
speak.
Sorry, my name is Kathy Jansen and I'm from South Africa. And I wasn't going to speak tonight, but after hearing the previous speakers, I need to say I'm a non-resident. I have been legally working in this country for a number of years. All my documents are in order. I've never broken any law. And I tell you, if it wasn't for the support of my pastor and my church, my principal and the teachers of my school, I don't think I would have been able to survive because of the pressure of immigration. I can tell the people I do pay Social Security, I do pay taxes, and besides that, I also pay attorney fees, I pay immigration fees, which I have to do every year. And I do understand where the illegal people are coming from because I can see what I'm going through. Many times I say, is it worth it? And I tell you, if it wasn't for my work that I'm doing, which is in great demand, not only in Alamance County, but in the USA because I work with autistic children and children with disabilities. If it wasn't for my love for the kids here, if it wasn't for the support I was getting for the community, I think I would have gone back. But I am determined to stay on, to fight the battle, even if I have to do it by myself. And for those illegal immigrants, I say, don't give up. And for the people that we are getting support from, I just want to say, thank you. Thank you very, very much.
Anybody else is seated in the left section here?
Thank you, gentlemen and ladies. I'm Sam Moser. I want to commend many people who spoke tonight. There's a lot of great points, and I think a lot of people are speaking from their heart, and that's important. The young lady that's a legal immigrant and doing well in the county, we're proud of her, and I think everyone in this room is proud of her and her family. The people that are here illegally, it kind of burdens me to think that the legal representatives seem to be supporting the illegal, the ones who have broken the law. So we're here to uphold the law. And I want to commend Sheriff Terry Johnson and his staff because I think that is their main objective, is to uphold the law. The gentleman, the pastor that spoke first, I didn't quite understand the verse that said, "Ye that are a curse, depart from me." And I'm still thinking about that, trying to try to understand exactly what that meant. But I'm concerned about the illegal immigrants and the cost to our county. Crime. I just got two or three articles through the years I've cut out of the paper. This is an article of our local city policeman in 2005. He said DWI rates are proportionally by Hispanics. It's out of control. City is worst in DWI. This is in the Daily Times News. This is a Burlington article. Our city was worst in DWI. illegal felon arrested on cocaine. This is 06. Suspected gang members may have Latinos, and this is not all Latinos, but this is the article that was in our local paper. It said Latinos are blamed for tax woes. It said county says false addresses the reason for many unpaid motor vehicle bills. Somebody has broken the law. Illegal immigrant with a history of drunken driving kills a Mount Holly school teacher in a collision. Hispanics getting large percentages of DWI arrests. We could go on and on and on, but these are issues that I think need to be addressed, and we need to make sure we don't have illegals in our county. Here's something else that was just in the paper recently. Births to illegal aliens surging, 2003. One gentleman says that we may hide to multiply, and that when that happens, you better look out. I don't know if that's a threat or just what that meant. It sounded like an arrogant threat. Here's an article by a guest columnist from Mebane in 2007. And he's saying that what is concerning the word illegal? Public officials, the word illegal is, every definition I have read is clear as its meaning, that which is a violation of our law by a law or regulation. It is also a crime for anyone to aid, giving jobs, encouraging or harboring them, or knowing, assisting illegal aliens due to personal convictions. Our natural resources, our water, our sewer systems, they're not going to be able to handle the increase if there's not some type of change in direction. The last sentence he says, "Wake up, America. We're losing our nation to a third country." Thank you. Thank you for time speaking.
Anybody else seated on the left? Anybody seated on the right? Anybody in the set? Yes, sir. Sergeant Buck.
Good evening. I'm Dan Ansbacher. I want to start by thanking you for two things. To have this public comment meeting is something I haven't seen at other boards, and I think it's a wonderful idea. And to have your meetings on the available on your internet site is also very valuable. I watched the last meeting on the internet, and I heard all of you speaking, and I thought the sense of the board was that we have no choice but to enforce these laws. And that's a point I'd like to address. I don't think all laws are enforced, and I don't think they're all enforced equally. I think that there are an example, I see Judge Robertson here, I think that in court every day people tell opposite stories. One of them is lying, but nobody gets charged with perjury. Nobody in the county is investigating that to see which one of those people lied. It's not a law that we're enforcing. We are choosing to enforce this law, and we could choose to enforce it to a lesser extent. The offenses that Mr. Moser was talking about, which are violent crimes, could and should be enforced without enforcing the law against harmless people. So you do have a choice. No, not all laws are enforced, and not all laws are enforced against everybody, regardless of circumstance. And I'd say one other thing. This law is being enforced partly because somebody else is paying for it. I don't think this board would have voted for this program if it were coming out of your own budget. I don't think you'd feel less fortunate. Thank you.
Anybody else in the CD section? In the CD section on the right? Yes, sir.
Yes, hello. My name is George Guzman. I'm in the National Guard. I went to Iraq in 2004. I'm going next year, too. I think the main problem here that they claim the illegal aliens is taking the jobs away from the American citizen. But the main problem is, look at where all the textiles are going, China. I think we should, all this free trade, we should close that and bring back the jobs to the Americans. Look at where Burlington Industry went to. All these textiles, they went to India, China. Well, that's all. Thanks.
Okay, there's a few people that were standing that when I went by them, they didn't want to speak. Yes, sir, you're the first one, I think.
Hello, everybody. My name is Kim Oliver. First thing I'd like to say is thank goodness for our Sheriff's Department. His associates, they do a super good job. I'd like to start by saying 13 years ago, I had my identity stolen. At that time, we didn't have the 287G. I wish we had it. I wake up every morning and go to bed every night wondering when the next time I'm going to pick up the phone or the phone's going to ring or I'm going to go to the mailbox and get a letter stating somebody else has got my identity. Well, lo and behold, 5 weeks ago, my wife gets a letter. There's two individuals in this country illegally using her Social Security number. You know, if you support illegal immigration and identity fraud, I'll be waiting at the back door. If you don't mind, get your Social Security card that I'd like to have the number. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
My name is Richard Johnson. I'd like to say a couple things. Why are people taking Social Security numbers? Because this government does not give them any alternative. A young lady who is as American as my 16-year-old daughter was faced with the decision, do I leave my country, her country, for maybe 10 or 15 years and probably leave her American citizen child here or break the law? That is not a decision any government can rightly ask them to make. Secondly, enforce all the laws. You're going to say that to the four men who went to the Woolworths lunch counter in Greensboro in the early 1960s and stood up against unfair laws? Are you saying, yes, we should have thrown Martin Luther King in jail? Yes, anyone who broke those segregation statutes should go to jail? The minister referred to Martin Luther King's letter from Birmingham jail. He wrote that from jail because he had been locked up for breaking those laws. And what he said was, all laws have to have a moral basis. They have to agree with the law of God. And if they disagree with those laws, then they are unjust laws and are not to be obeyed. And he pointed to the laws in the communist countries that made Christianity illegal, and he pointed to, and I'm not comparing anyone to Nazis, so don't overthrow it, but he compared it to, would you have agreed with the Nazi laws? Now, none of you gentlemen would. You wouldn't, and Sheriff Johnson certainly would not. But the point is, if you are going to make the point that all laws should be enforced, you have to enforce the segregation laws and those. Plus, where's the fire marshal? We were told we're probably breaking the fire code. What you gentlemen did, and ladies, make a very logical choice. We need to have democracy, so we are not going to enforce that law for now. All we are saying is we need humanity, we need justice in this country, and maybe the immigration statutes are too screwed up to enforce this way and throw out people like Mojave and her little child.
Right.
Gentlemen, ma'am, my name is Forrest Hazel. I live in Mebane. I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you. I'm not going to take it. First, I'd like to say that I worked 10 years in law enforcement, so I understand what that's like. I think Terry Johnson has done a fine job. Every time anybody's come out to my house, they've always been very professional. I don't have any complaints. I do think that if the memorandum of understanding says that we're going to do certain things, I think we need to do them. I think if we don't, we're opening ourselves up to problems here in Alamance County. I've heard a lot of people speak here tonight from both sides. I'm not going to try to elaborate much because many of them have done much better than I could. I'll just say that I think that most of us here in Alamance County are good, decent, church-going people. And I think that whatever side of this issue you're on, I think we ought to remember that we're better off if we don't talk at each other, but if we talk with each other. I think that we can enforce the law, but I think we should try to do it in a way that's compassionate and merciful and just remembers that all the folks here, whether they're illegal or legal, and I think sometimes we forget that a lot of the Hispanic people here are legal citizens, but they're human beings, just like the rest of us. And they're here, maybe they ought not to be, but they're here, and I think that while they're here, they're entitled to a little human decency and compassion. I think as long as we can do that, we'll be all right. Thank you.
Thank you for this hearing. It's wonderful. If we're going to be Americans, I think this is a great way to go. And it's great to hear from all sides. However, I want to remind you that Ronald Reagan was in favor of amnesty, and that's the last time the federal people passed much of a law. And actually, 287G has been passed as part of the Homeland Security Act, and it has not been gone through the courts as to whether it's legal or illegal. As a matter of fact, it could be an illegal delegation of the power of the federal government, because that's where immigration belongs. And it's been delegated to a few sheriffs, a few counties, I think three in North Carolina. And I know that people want to do what they want to do. But in the last payoff, it is a federal job to enforce immigration, and they've delegated it to certain sheriffs. Now, I think that we are forgetting that we are human beings and that we ultimately have to have some humanity. Actually, we are not on the high list of humanity in the state, and I hate to see that happen to Alamance County. I do think that we must remember that it is a federal law. The reason we're in the mess we're in is because it has not been enforced anywhere for years. And I want, before I leave, and thank you for letting me have I hope the last go right. So please remember humanity. People are human beings, not animals. We cannot regard them as somebody that's distant. They are people, and we have to remember that. No matter what the laws are, we still have to inject some humanity in the enforcement. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, how y'all doing? My name is Lyndon Jennings. I've been here in Alamance County all my life. I have traveled to Mexico. I come back in January. I think that we should respect the Hispanic people. I went to Mexico City, and those people respected me with open arms while we can't do the same.
Thank
nobody else, we'll now close the public comment section. Thank you to everybody for the comments. Next on the agenda is the proposed Family Justice Center. Judge David Robson will present that as well.
Just gonna wait one moment for my PowerPoint presentation. Come up and to reveal my lack of knowledge of technology. Chairman Shar, Commissioner Sutton, Commissioner Vaughn, Commissioner Engel, Commissioner Lashley, I do appreciate you finding some time to squeeze in one more matter on this very busy docket tonight. For the record, I'm Jim Robertson. I'm Chief District Court Judge here in Alamance County, but tonight I'm here representing a collaboration of agencies, organizations, and individuals who are seeking to address a problem. And this is the problem. We have a problem in our county of providing timely and appropriate assistance to victims of abuse. I see this every day. That's what I do. I go home and complain to my wife who's here tonight about the inability to get speaking, it's a collaboration of folks. It's for an Alamance County Family Justice Center, which I'll tell you a bit more about. Why I'm here tonight is in order to make a Family Justice Center a viable option here, a reality in Alamance County, we need your help. We absolutely need your help. The Family Justice Center concept is this, is to have a one-shot, one-stop center for victims and their children, and worst of all, children victims. We'd like to get professional services for these victims of abuse housed under one roof as much as possible, and to reduce the number of places that victims have to go to tell their story, to seek services, so that we don't re-victimize the victim. To put this in perspective, here's some statistics from just three of the organizations that I'm here. There it went. There we go. Three of the organizations that I'm here speaking on behalf of tonight. Family Abuse Services, which is our, that's a private nonprofit organization which helps with domestic violence matters. I want you to look at that. 390 protective orders were issued during the 12 months ending June 30th, 2008. That's right here in Little Alamance County. Sometimes they're called 50 Bs. Maybe you've heard of it in that name. Sometimes they call them B-52s, but they're 50 Bs. 390. Crossroads, our fine sexual assault response center, deals with sexual assault matters. 401 sexual assaults on adults and children. And the Department of Social Services, which on a daily basis deals with multiple reports, 722 reports of child sexual abuse and domestic violence. Now, if you would visualize each of those cases coming to those organizations and then multiple referrals of those folks to other services that are needed to deal with these victims' problems and their issues, and you can imagine the massive perspective of this entire problem. Currently, the victim is the common link in this process, but this is what it looks like. Our services are spread all over the county, all over various cities and communities, and the victim is responsible for going to all those places where services might be needed. You can imagine the Herculean effort that's necessary for a victim to do that. The current situation is that we are scattered. We are scattered all around, and we unwittingly traumatize and victimize the victims. Despite all the good hearts of these fine people that are represented by these blocks, to help the victims. To go everywhere is an amazing effort on the part of the victim, and especially so at a time where the victim is so vulnerable and disadvantaged. That's what it looks like now. Now, we've got people that are working and have been working for years to try to make this work, make this come together, and they do great jobs. And it's a public and a private partnership, as you can see up there. But this is the family justice concept. The family justice concept is to get those folks under the umbrella of one center. That is to try to get those agencies as much as possible, either a representative from those agencies or an entire agency, in a single location where the victim is truly the center of the services. If the victim is the center of the process, it'll be a place where the victim is there and the services can come to the victim. And that way you know you're getting the right services to your victim at the right time without a lot of waste of time and frustration. Everybody here knows a victim. Everybody. And knows the frustration that came from that. And that's why not just Jim Robertson standing here, but a lot of folks are asking the county commissioners for some help, for a hand up here. Now, didn't want to pack the audience, but I did want you to see that it's not just me speaking here. I know, for example, we have Clerk of Superior Court, Diane Pickett, kind enough to be here. Diane, if you could raise your hand. Supporting the concept of a family justice center. Chairman of the Crossroads, Mr. Phil Bowers, is here. Very supportive and involved in that. Gary Ander, who works with the Department of Social Services, is absolutely instrumental. There's Cindy Brady, who's with the United Way, extremely interested in this. We have a group of folks, and thank you for being here, from the Burlington Police Department, who show their support for helping victims here in Alamance County. We have George Siriano, thank you, George, with Family Abuse Services, who's here showing her support for everything. I have left out many people, but I'm going to try to make this brief. These are folks, it's a collaborative effort of these folks and others to ask you for help, because we cannot make this work without your help. I've studied it, it doesn't work, and we need your help. So, I mentioned a lot of people, but I did not mention until right now one of the strongest supporters of the Family Justice Center, and I'd like to ask him for a few comments right now. I'd like to defer to Sheriff Terry Johnson for a few comments on your thoughts. Sheriff Johnson.
Thank you, Judge. Commissioners, one of the first things that I noticed taking office about 6 years ago was a tremendous amount of domestic violence occurring in the county. And on a day-to-day basis, there was nothing any more disheartening than the number of domestic violence cases that were coming into the sheriff's office, and I know the other law enforcement agencies in this county. And it was also disheartening to see a victim have to go here and come back. Where do you say I'm supposed to go, or where is that at? It would be so great to have all this under one roof as a family justice center. And in the long run, I think it's going to save the taxpayers money in doing it this way. Most of the homicides that occur in this county is domestic violence related. And we need to do everything we possibly can to make sure our victims are treated as a victim and not be, you go here, you go there. Because after a while, I'll be honest with you, if I was one of the victims, I'd say, heck with this. And I think this is a concept that will eventually catch on nationwide. And it is definitely needed in Alamance County because of the number of cases that we're encountering all law enforcement agencies. If you have any questions, I'll try to answer what I can.
Let me ask you a question. What's it going to cost the county? Are we going to have to supply people for that business that are taxpayers? I mean, tax paid by the county.
What we're asking for, Sheriff, if I could intercede, what we're asking for is a location. These folks will solve the problem. They will be your people. They will do what's necessary to address the problem. We just need a place to have this. And if we can have a place, you won't have to worry about the county commissioners having to have personnel over there to make this thing run. That will be the responsibility of these various agencies or these individuals to do that. So I hope that answers the question.
For instance, I intend to assign a domestic violence unit to that particular center if, in fact, it is granted by the commissioners. And I'm sure some of the other law enforcement agencies is going to be sending staff. So when the problem comes, it can all be handled under one roof.
I have personally carried several victims of domestic violence through the process of obtaining the 50B order. And it's a lengthy thing. Just based on the logistics and getting them from point A to point B, like Judge Robinson said, and this would be an asset. If we're able to pull this off, it would be an asset for the county.
It would also be a safety issue. We have honestly had husbands run their wives once they walk out the courtroom into the sheriff's office trying to get out of them that we've had to intervene.
I'd like to make a motion that we designate a building and probably the one on Martin Street.
Yes, ODSS building.
ODSS building as the victims advocacy building. To house this, I think it's a wonderful idea. I think it's
going to
I will second that motion.
Mr. Smith, any comments about that?
I've talked to Judge Robinson and most of the agencies that are involved and have explained to them that we are in the process of renovating and remodeling the ODSS building. The only, and I have no plans for the use of that building. I was going to leave it up to the commissioners who and what they wanted to put in there, except for one half of the basement floor, not the main floor, but the basement floor. We're hoping to put the fire marshal's office in there because CECOM has to be expanded when we go into the 800 megahertz next year. Other than that, three-fourths of that building, staff has no plans for it at this point. It's entirely up to the county commission.
Judge, would that building be sufficient even though we lose part of that?
That absolutely would be sufficient. I've been over there. The county management has been kind enough to allow me to tour it. That would provide the very needs we're talking about at Martin Street property. With the fire marshal in that space, that would still leave plenty of space for exactly what we're talking about. We could be first in North Carolina to do this.
And that building, the plans on finishing that building are part of the money that we're borrowing at the facilities rehabilitation, and would be probably the first one complete. It's been gutted, it's in good sound condition now. The main thing are HVAC, and then setting up walls and things like that. Been sitting there for 10 years not being used.
Do we know when it will be available approximately?
Whenever y'all bring the bottom
line. All righty.
So it wasn't included in the
part.
It was? Okay.
Yes,
sir. Judge, are you just asking for use of the facility and not the utilities and et cetera?
That is correct. The use of that facility that gift to the victims of domestic violence and abuse and sexual abuse in our county would allow these agencies to take care of that, the ongoing expense of utilities and the technological expenses associated with that, personnel and things of that. So that's what I'm asking. I appreciate the motion.
We just want a house.
That's correct.
We have a motion set. Is there any further discussion? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming. Thank you. The first in the state, is that correct, Jim?
That's correct. Thank you.
Okay, next we have some finance matters to deal with. First one is a Parks and Rec budget amendment.
Good evening, Commissioners. Here this evening to ask that you approve an amendment to the Recreation Department's budget in the amount of $5,000. This $5,000 is a grant from the state of North Carolina's Adopt a Trail program. This is a grant we entered into an agreement with the city of Graham to work with them to do some improvements to the Alder Trail in their jurisdiction. So this is 100% state funds. I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Any questions? Do you have a motion?
My motion.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next is a budget amendment for the service department. Sheriff?
We're up here before you. The last meeting asked about transfer of funds, and I found out from the finance that I think there was a misunderstanding. We're asking that $44,700 be transferred from our federal vice funds to capital outlay equipment to be able to buy the pistols that we talked about, because ours are over 10 years old, and also the leather gear that goes with us, pistol, forest, and holster. And like I said, it was just, I don't know what went before you. I know what I told you. And that's what we're needing, and we'll make sure we're clear.
Okay, thank you. Do you have a motion?
So moved.
You second? All discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Sheriff.
Thank you all very much.
Next is the health department budget. Mr. Bass?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have received notification from the Minority Infant Health Reduction Program and Healthy Beginnings of a $45,833 grant that we will be using to improve infant health working in the Eastbrook community. This is a faith-based initiative where we will be working also with other community partners in this program. Again, it is 100% funded by the state, and it is contingent upon our performance, but I have all the assurances that we'll do a great job in providing these services, sir.
Have a motion?
Motion.
Second. Second. Discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Thanks, sir. Okay.
Next is sewer capital projects.
Good evening. Tonight before you is a budget amendment to budget funds that will receive 75% from state and 25% county match to fund capital improvement plans for the school system that was approved at a previous meeting for the application. Those have been approved state funds of $918,750, the county match being $306,250.
Okay. Any questions?
Is that lottery money?
Not on this one, Mr. Sutton. This is the 25% match to fund those.
Do you have a motion?
Second.
Second. Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? So, motion carries.
Thank you.
Next, we'll have the Sheriff and Major Britt to give their report.
Commissioners, I'm going to let Major Britt give most of this particular report. I want you to understand that we were requested to look into the Alamance County Health Department. Being a department head in the county, I felt that we should have an independent individual or independent agency do the investigation, because we simply work with all those departments in the county. Major Britt and Tim Camadeus has put in numerous hours on this presentation. And I don't want you to shoot the messenger. Shoot the sheriff. And at this time, I would like to bring Major Britt up here and let you know, folks, that we're only reporting the findings of the investigation and what some of the problems that we've run into. And I hope that each of you will look at this. You have a manual in front of you, family and children, Medicaid manual. You also in there have a disc of this entire presentation. I want you to study it, because there need to be some changes. At this time, I'd like to present Major Britt.
Good evening, Commissioners. I agree with the sheriff. If you're going to shoot somebody, shoot him.
Can I ask a question before you start?
Yes, ma'am.
Is this the report coming from the SBI going to the county manager, going to you?
Part of this does entail the SBI investigation, yes, ma'am. Does that answer your question? Okay, Monday, June 23rd, 2008, the SBI initiated an investigation into allegations that employees of the Alamance County Health Department, specifically Dr. Kathleen Shapley Quinn, and Nurse Karen Saxer were knowingly and willingly falsifying patient medical records. Sheriff Johnson sought the assistance of the SBI to request of County Manager David Smith. This request was made by County Manager Smith, was based on concerns brought to his attention by Commissioner William Lashley and Board of Health Chairman Keith Whitey. The allegations were specifically that at the request of some patients, Alamance County Health Department provided work notes and prescriptions in alias names. Providing these services would assist illegal aliens in maintaining assumed or stolen identities, which may be a violation of state or federal law. And those laws would pertain to identity theft and fraud. And those were the allegations. Interviews were conducted with the nursing administration and nursing staff. The staff was divided, with some believing the practice of writing work notes utilizing aliases to suspected illegal aliens was wrong, and therefore they refused to do so. Subsequently, they reported feeling pressured or feeling repercussions for taking this stance. Others, particularly Shapley Quinn and Saxer, believed the guidance they had sought and received was vague at best, believed their actions did not violate any law, and that they were providing the best care for their patients. Furthermore, according to Dr. Quinn and Saxer, an illegal alien cannot be refused medical care. They did seek out various sources of information. I'm going to try to go over a few of those with you. But during the course of this investigation, Shapley Quinn stated she had sought various legal guidance. Based on this, investigators obtained a court order or search warrant to allow for the review of Dr. Shapley Quinn's email correspondence. Now, this order was specifically to her county email accounts. Of the thousands of emails that were reviewed, several were found to be relevant to issues regarding to the specific focus of this investigation. This is an example of one correspondence, and it was from Jill Moore, who is a Master's of Public Health at UNC Institute of Government. This correspondence was on May 21st, 2007, and this is an email. Specifically, Dr. Moore's guidance is that there are several different approaches a health department might take in regards to alias names. If a patient has an employee ID number, a department may choose to use only the ID number on the note and not include the name at all. The second option she gave was a department might choose to write notes only in the name they believe to be the patient's real name, even if this differs from what they know to be the patient's work name. A department could put both names on the note. An example would be Jane Smith, a.k.a. Mary Jones. The fourth option was some health departments have considered putting only work names on the notes, provided they are certain the person requesting the note really does not use the other name at work and is not simply trying to get a note for another person. In summary, Dr. Moore's summary was the first three approaches are clearly the least risky practices. The last approach seems riskier. That's her words. But it is not clear that it violates any civil or criminal laws. However, it is possible that under some circumstances, the health department's actions could amount to fraud against the employer. And then there's the definition of fraud, and it basically states that it falsely represents or conceals a material fact and does so in a manner that is reasonably calculated to deceive another party, and does so with intent to deceive, and does in fact deceive the other party. And this is the elements to civil liability for fraud. A second correspondence by Dr. Moore, actually from Dr. Quinn to Dr. Moore, what I want to focus on here specifically is the last paragraph. Dr. Quinn states, I think previously we at Alamance County Health Department talked about filling out notes, but having the patient fill in their own name on the note. We use a prescription pad, so this kind of works smoothly. Does this make sense? Thanks, Kathleen. Here again, Dr. Quinn has had some correspondence with Assistant County Attorney Clyde Albright. Call your attention to the second. Well, I did what the judge did there. Call your attention to the second paragraph. I called UNC Hospital's legal department to see if they have a policy on the use of multiple names. They do not and have not had any issues that have come before their legal department in this arena. On more than one occasion, Nurse Karen Saxer, at the direction of Dr. Shapley Quinn, prepared or made health-related employer work notes for patients under alias names, knowing the names on the documents were in fact not the birth name or legal name of the patient. As a result of interviews, there were 5 specific individuals who were identified. This investigation remains specifically limited and focused to these 5 individuals. So there was no wholesale going to the health department, going through records. Through the interviews, 5 people were identified. The focus of this investigation remained on those 5 people. This is one of the 5 people of interest, Maria Sanchez. Veronica Ayers of Texas reported on May 2, 2008 to the Alamance County Sheriff's Office that someone in Swepsonville, North Carolina had stolen her identity and was using the same to be employed. Ms. Ayers became aware of this because she received notification from the Internal Revenue Service about unpaid taxes on her job in North Carolina. She didn't have a job in North Carolina. Maria Sanchez was arrested on May 6, 2008 by Alamance County Sheriff's Office investigators for stealing and using the identity of Veronica Ayers. Sanchez used the name, social security number, and date of birth of Veronica Ayers, who is a living resident of Texas. As a post-arrest procedure, Maria Sanchez was processed under the 287G program and identified as an illegal alien. She was subsequently processed for deportation. Sanchez was provided work notes by the Alamance County Health Department to return to work at Honda Power Equipment. Now, this created substantial tax implications for the real Veronica Ayers, who is a lawful U.S. resident and citizen. Medicaid investigators with the State Bureau of Investigation and the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services were requested to review the files of these 5 individuals to determine if Medicaid fraud had been committed. I'd like to add right here, on these 5 individuals, if you'll notice, if they had committed no other crime, there was no further step taken. I picked up some tonight that there were some concerns about certain groups of people being targeted for their immigration status. The other 4 individuals never went toward the immigration part of this. There was no other crime. The purpose for requesting the SBI and Health and Human Services, which is a federal entity, was due to the fact that there may be information contained in medical files that are protected under HIPAA. Both agencies have oversight and authority to review such files while complying with HIPAA and confidentiality laws. Investigation revealed that Medicaid applications were made at the Alamance County Department of Social Services and on a limited occasions at 4 outposts. Upon review by the SBI and HHS, Health and Human Services, it was determined that none of the 5 individuals received Medicaid benefits in violation of any law, but that their services were absorbed in large by local funding, particularly Alamance County Health Department maternal health budget, line section 101. I have an excerpt of that line item for you. Below is a section of the health budget expenditures for 2007-2008. This section applies to maternal health budget line item 101. If you'll see there in red, I think I'm off the screen there, but in that year, $659,605.63 was spent. Now, this is an item that is voluntarily funded and has been so, my understanding, since back in the 1950s. This is basically prenatal. It's what you would call this is the prenatal section. Now, the state tracks through Medicaid emergency services for non-citizens. Alamance County must fund 5.6% of this. If you will see here, in that same fiscal year 2007, and that's our county, Alamance County, we spent $1,526,648 on 427 recipients at an average cost of $35.75. Statewide in 2007, emergency services for non-citizens we spent $60,377,661. This data is come straight from the state of North Carolina paid claims data on the state website for Health and Human Services. While we're on that subject, our neighboring county, Guilford County, during the same time frame, spent $3,196,000. Orange County spent $954,000. Randolph County, $1,346,000. Chatham County, $1,242,897. And our part of local funds would have been $85,492.12. It was determined that work notes were provided in alias names by members of the health department, specifically Karen Saxer at the specific direction of Dr. Shadley Quinn. There was no evidence found supporting the allegation of prescriptions being written in alias names. The explanation for this would be the aforementioned work notes that she talked about that they did on prescription pads. It was a practice that Dr. Quinn had stated that they used the prescription pads to write the work notes on. It also should be noted that Karen Saxrain had also, during interviews, admitted that she on at least five occasions wrote these type work notes. A summary of this investigation was provided to Assistant U.S. Attorney Arnold Husser, U.S. District Court, Middle District of North Carolina, to see if any federal charges would be appropriate. U.S. Attorney Husser declined prosecution at this time. This last one has changed now. This matter is pending final review. I understand that shortly after 5 p.m., Rob Johnson, and I put a copy in your manuals, has declined prosecution as well. During the course of this, it became necessary to try to understand the Medicaid application process. At issue was whether or not Medicaid fraud had been committed, and in trying to understand that and determine that the applications are actually made at the Department of Social Services, we did a review of the process. And in order to gain that clear understanding, I asked Susan Osborne if she could process me through a simulated Medicaid application procedure. She made arrangements for that with some of her staff and provided me a copy of a manual, which you guys have now been provided with. During the course of that, there were four specific areas that called our attention and seemed to be conflicting policies and mandates, and I think areas that made it difficult for those folks to do their job. The first one, and this is all from the Family and Children's Medicaid manual, the numbers to the right is the section that's in the manual that you have in front of you. The confidentiality, rules and regulations, the fraud, policy and abuse, and, of course, the National Voter Registration Act as it applies to public assistance applicant registration, which is part of your manual. For a person to be eligible for full Medicaid, they must be a U.S. citizen or an alien admitted to the United States by the United States Customs and Immigration Service under a specific immigration status. Immigrants who do not meet this requirement or citizens for whom citizenship and identity are questionable are eligible for emergency Medicaid services only. And that would have been the figures I gave you, the $1.5 million and the $60 million statewide. If you're not a citizen, then you can get the emergency. Childbirth is emergency, as well as other medical emergencies. Thought this was interesting. Aliens who seek admission to the U.S. must establish that they will not become public charges. If an alien comes through and goes through the legal process and gets the appropriate documentation, one of the requirements is that they will not become a public charge. They are not entitled to public assistance. And there's a period of time of 5 to 7 years before they can do that. So people who go about it the right way don't get these services. Part of the manual requires that applicants identified as illegally in the U.S. who are applying for Medicaid or North Carolina Health Choice, which is North Carolina's version of Medicaid, are not subject to any reporting requirements and should not be reported to the USCIS or Immigration and Customs. Also, persons who apply for benefits on behalf of others, an example would be a mother applying for her eligible child, are not subject to any reporting requirements themselves. Verification procedures. The IMC, or Income Maintenance Caseworker, which is a DSS employee, must verify alien status for all qualified aliens through the Systematic Alien Verification for Entitlements Program, or SAVE, that's what I'll call it from here out. The U.S. Department of Homeland Security SAVE system is used for verifying the status of an alien in order to determine their eligibility for Medicaid. This is a web-based system used to verify the authenticity of an alien's documents, their date of admission, and their current immigration status. This is an example of a SAVE document with the appropriate information redacted. This is performed by the folks at DSS, the income maintenance worker. If you'll pay attention, this is the lower right corner, and this is an actual document. This document was returned from Homeland Security to our DSS stating that the documents were counterfeit. This is a letter from the to the Director of Social Services, and I'll bring your attention to two areas. The purpose of this letter is to clarify the policy for county departments of social services for addressing the use of multiple names and or social security numbers. Based on citizenship and immigration status when applying for work first benefits. This is the same document uploaded up the lower paragraph. DSS is responsible for determining eligibility of all who are included in the work first application. During the course of application, DSS may learn that a member of a budget unit, that's the folks applying, uses an alternate name and or social security number or numbers, DS, for employment purposes. Work First policy requires that the agency include the income and resources of all individuals in the budget unit, regardless of their citizenship or immigration status. Verification income must be pursued under all names and social security numbers provided during the course of the application process. And this is what the state says per their policy.
May I ask a question, please?
Yes, sir.
Did you go back one?
Yes, sir.
The administrative letter, who was that from? I didn't see it from.
From the state.
Oh, so that's the state?
Yes, sir, right okay. There is the entire document.
Okay.
It's an administrative letter, and my understanding is they send those out for clarification on policies and procedures. And I think Ms. Osborne's here probably would be glad to. But this is basically saying use the numbers. Now, here's the state's policy from the manual in front of you. The DSS must verify citizenship and immigration status of an applicant or recipient. Verifications received during this process from the SAVE system indicating invalid documents due to counterfeit status, which I just showed you, was an actual one, cannot be released to law enforcement. DSS is required by state policy to continue with the eligibility determination of all other household members. Now, this is in the citizen alien requirements. Now we're going to get to the confidentiality section. I know this seems like we're jumping a little bit, but I want you to start to see from one section of the book to the other how it conflicts and how folks are trying to figure out what they're supposed to do when in the one book they've got five different directions they're supposed to go. Section 5 specifically speaks to law enforcement fraud investigation. Law enforcement personnel conducting or assisting in an investigation or prosecution related to Medicaid fraud may be given information or evidence pertinent to an alleged fraud. The last section said they can't give it to you. Otherwise, no information may be given to law enforcement unless under court order. Release of information to other agencies. Information from an applicant or recipient's case record may not be released to other agencies, such as public housing, legal services, private organizations, immigration services, employment security commissions, school lunch programs, health departments, or elected officials without the client's consent. All rules of confidentiality must be applied in regard to alien status. It is a breach of confidentiality to discuss the alien status of an individual with an employer, landlord, etc. hit my button here. Now, in their fraud policy, same book, the state says both the state and the county departments of social services have a legal obligation to assure the proper administration of public funds and an obligation to take necessary legal steps in cases of fraud or misrepresentation. I argue that false social security numbers is probably a pretty good case of misrepresentation. This obligation rests on the efficiency, thoroughness, and integrity of the process by which initial and continuing eligibility are determined. This is the Federal Privacy Act, and I know we're getting late. This basically just allows, again, for law enforcement in relations to frauds or other civil or criminal investigations to get information. The state's definition of fraud is by law a crime against society that can only be determined in criminal court. It is the willful and intentional act that creates the crime. A client is suspected of fraud when the client willfully and knowingly, with intent to deceive, makes a false statement or misrepresentation, or fails to disclose a material fact, or does not report changes in income or other eligibility factors, and as a result, attempts to obtain or continues to receive assistance. The state also directs our DSS directors to inform the public about their attempts to prevent fraud and abuse, and that it is important both as a deterrent and a public relations measure. Information regarding court actions, amount of recoupments, should be made public. You should publicize your phone number to call and report cases of possible fraud and abuse, stressing that such reports are confidential. Again, the public awareness flies right in the face of the previous directives. Now we get to the National Voter Registration Act as it applies to public assistance applicants. There have been questions raised about the potential of voter fraud being committed as a result of ineligible applicants who may have been registered to vote during this process. Questions of public confidence in our voter registration in Alamance County have arisen as it applies to the NVRA. What is the NVRA, or who does it apply to? All North Carolinians who apply for or receive services or benefits under one of 13 programs. Medicaid is one of those programs, and for the sake of time, I'm not going to read, but they're all public assistance programs. What is it? It's the opportunity to register to vote or update voter registration while applying for benefits or renewing benefits, or reporting a change of address at one of the above programs. Where does this occur? At any agency office that administers services or benefits under one of the programs listed above. Why? It's the law. The purpose of the law is to make the voter registration process more accessible to all eligible voters. How does this occur? Agency staff must offer the applicant the opportunity to register to vote and the necessary forms. Staff are required to provide the same level of assistance in completion of the voter registration form as would be offered in the completion of any agency form. Completed forms must be transmitted within 5 days to the County Board of Elections. Who determines eligibility? It is the responsibility of the County Board of Elections and not agency personnel to determine eligibility of clients to register to vote in North Carolina. I underline this. I think this is important. If an agency registration staff, that's the DSS caseworker, questions the eligibility of a particular client, the best procedure would be to allow the client to complete the voter registration application and transmit the application to the proper County Board of Elections. That's what the state says. They question. Then it says the County Board of Elections will utilize all available resources to verify the information on the application. And I did go over and speak with the folks at our local board, and they have a couple procedures in place. They check all databases, Social Security, driver's license, and make an attempt to verify and determine the eligibility of this person. If they cannot determine it, my understanding is they're marked in the book, so the first time they show up to vote at a poll place, they're required to present identification to the judge. If they're unable to do this or determine the eligibility, they vote a provisional ballot. So that it would come in after the fact if it was a question
there is something that could be contested after the election. There's been a lot of tension in the press regarding illegal aliens and access to government services. This essentially says what prevents non-citizens from registering. It basically goes through and tells you you have to be a United States citizen. Holding a green card or visa does not allow you to vote. And it basically says that if you check the box and false attestation to your citizenship, it's grounds for deportation, and you'll be forever barred from becoming a citizen of America. Just a continuation of the briefing I just gave you there. It does say that unless the staff knowingly aids a non-citizen in providing false information, the agency representative cannot be held liable. And that's according to the North Carolina State Bar of Elections Training Manual. From February to October 2007, over 24,000 new voters were registered at county DSS offices across North Carolina. This is according to the North Carolina State Board of Elections. Here locally, from January to July, 191 were registered. This is one of the lowest, this is a very low number compared to some of other counties. And our local director has been at odds with the state board. Specifically, in they feel that it's harassing to have to ask them each and every time they come in to vote. Also, in the logistics of trying to register people to vote while they're trying to handle public assistance, determine eligibility, determine income, determine all the things they have to determine to provide the services, and they still have to register them to vote as well. The most significant issue revealed during this review appears to be logistics of the registration system required of DSS. How are employees of DSS able to ensure the integrity of the registration when they are prohibited from addressing questions of immigration status? According to the confidentiality clause, they can't report to outside agencies that there's an immigration issue. So during the course of doing the voter registration, if they know by running the number that there's an immigration issue, they're barred from reporting to the Board of Elections that there's an immigration issue. They're also told to pass them on along. This presents a problem. But a review of public records did determine that none of the persons of interest, the five folks in this health department investigation, have ever registered to vote in North Carolina. They had not. Interviews were conducted with Director Susan Osborne and her staff. There was one common theme in the interviews. Staff members expressed a great deal of frustration with the conflicting policies and mandates that you have seen in the previous slides. And we tried to hit the high points. I think if you review that book, it's alarming. Employees additionally expressed concerns that their mission is to provide services and assistance to those that are entitled and in need, and not to those that are ineligible or recruited by law. In addition, current state policies prevents law enforcement notification even for apparent fraud. Questions? And I did that a lot faster. I can tell y'all what tired. I hope I didn't get too tired.
And that's state law, right?
Yes.
Okay. What did the feds say?
The feds declined prosecution as well.
And when that's apparent fraud, they can't report it?
No. The guidelines, I don't know what the state HHS policy is.
No, I'm talking about federal.
Yeah. Our local board of DSS, our local board of health operates under governing bodies from the state that sets their policies and procedures, as you see there. And actually, and specifically, even with Dr. Quinn and with Director Osborne, they had made several attempts and letters, can we do this? And specifically asking about like the SAVE documents, the alien verification into entitlements documents. One of the things the Director Osborne's been doing is keeping a log. They have been specifically told they can't report it by the state, but she's maintained a log there. At least according, we've not viewed it, but she says they're keeping a log of all the ones that come back in a counterfeit status or there's problems with it if it ever becomes an issue. The other thing, there was one section about we can investigate fraud. The staff can't call and say, hey, I got a fraud over here. They're precluded by doing that. What they can do is if I walk in and say, Director Osborne, I'm investigating Tim Britt. I think he's committed fraud. Here it is in writing. I would like to review
to see if he's committed Medicaid fraud. Then they're under an obligation to provide me that information. But she can't call me and say, hey, I've got Tim Britt over here committing Medicaid fraud. That, in a nutshell, is the biggest problem with that. And I think, like I said, I think if you'll review, there's a copy of this in each one of your books, and I highlighted those areas where there were conflicting policies.
During the course of the investigation, the five patients at the health department, at any time, did the investigators have to go into their medical records?
No, the purpose in calling, and I'm glad you brought that up, Commissioner, because I think there's been a lot of media attention about that. The purpose in calling the Federal Health and Human Services and the SBI Medicaid Union is they have specific authority and oversight over Medicaid fraud. So by calling them in, they can go in and review that file, determine if Medicaid benefits were received in violation of any law, at which time they would report to us. So the sheriff's office did not review medical records. The purpose in calling HHS was specifically to do that and comply with confidentiality and HIPAA laws. I think somewhere in that it's got lost. And also the investigation was focused to those five individuals. And the only one named was the one that was arrested, Ms. Sanchez, with the identity theft.
Can I ask Susan a question? Susan, when is the process when you actually, or a staff member actually register someone to vote? I mean, before their Social Security number is verified?
We have to offer, for the National Voter Registration Act, we have to offer it when they apply for benefits, when they come back to recertify, and for any change of address. So when they're applying for benefits, they're offered, we're required to offer that service. When they're an applicant.
And that's before you
yes, sir.
Get the results
yes,
from
sir.
Their Social Security.
Yes, sir.
Do you have any way of knowing how many actually vote? You know,
yeah.
It's one thing to register to vote, but then maybe another thing that they actually do.
No, we transmit everything to the Department of Elections and
within
5 days. And, other than keeping a log of our numbers, that's all we know.
Thank you.
When you interviewed the people, specifically Chaplain Quinn, Ms. Saxer, was everybody forthright? Was there any deception?
No.
None at all.
And they were interviewed with their counsel through the SCI. Both Dr. Quinn and Nurse Saxer both were represented by counsel during the interviews. And both admitted to the practice. Actually, Dr. Quinn had reached out for legal advice. Those were the two emails I went over. In trying to determine, she additionally had drafted a policy that she had not presented to her board. I actually have copies of that, if y'all would like those. And she had drafted a policy on use of alien names and had never had an opportunity to present to her board prior to the investigation.
Was the Institute of Government the only contact that was detected in regards to an interpretation of this?
Other than the one email where she simply informed Mr. Albright that she had reached out, to UNC's legal department, University of North Carolina Hospitals, and they had reported to her that they had not had that problem.
See, the Institute of Government is not a law-making body or an enforcement agency. You know, they interpret law, and it's hard to understand why an effort wasn't made. Looks like they would have been able to answer the question as to why you didn't go to an agency who is the law agency that makes the law versus somebody who interprets it. Because I don't agree with a lot of it, the Institute of Government comments on it.
Yes, and predominantly the lion's share of her correspondence were with the Institute of Government, specifically Jill Moore.
And one question about the voter registration situation is, are we hearing tonight that you cannot hold the registration form until you verify that they're qualified for services. You cannot get it to them in a secondary stage.
Yes, sir. We're required to offer voter registration services to all applicants.
All.
All applicants, unless they knowingly know they are not a citizen.
Okay. Well, forgive me. If you know that they're not, and you turn down their services.
Then we wouldn't offer voter registration.
Okay. Have you ever taken back an application or registration after you found out that he qualified?
I don't know that we have. If you know, many times we have folks who are applying on behalf of family members who are qualified, and so they would say that they're here for someone else and that they're not legal in the United States. We would not register them to vote.
But we did verify the five individuals, and none of those individuals had registered to vote. And I think that there's a pretty good system in at the Board of Elections, and talking to Ms. Holland, they're verifying all databases. And if they can't determine through Social Security, there's a system to check the Social Security number for validity through DMV, various other areas, then actually the person is still in the system, but if they show up to vote, they have to provide identification at that point, and if they can't provide that, then they vote a provisional ballot. And that's my understanding. I think she's here if they have any questions of her, but they go through each one.
Kathy, here. Everything that Major Smith said, correct, yeah. Concerning the process that y'all follow on verifying?
Yes, our process is that we receive our registrations from the Department of Social Service, and our understanding is that if they knowingly know that a person is not a citizen, they are not to forward that to us. Whoever's registration we get, whether it's yours, a change, or whatever, everybody is interfaced to the DMV and the Social Security system, and that's our backup. If those numbers don't match, the same as Mr. Britt said, they are put as a temporary registrant, and they are held until election day or until they show up.
Question, Kathy. If the numbers don't match, if it doesn't match up with name and Social Security number, DSS, according to the state, cannot report them to law enforcement. Can you?
Well, I wouldn't report them because I don't know that it's an offense. What I would do is not make them a registered voter. I wouldn't know that they weren't legal. I would just know that their information didn't match. Say if you registered, and you know how you write things down incorrectly sometimes, and you wrote your number down wrong, your Social Security number or your driver's license number, when it went through all the systems, it would come up that it didn't match. Now, I wouldn't know that necessarily it was legal or illegal. It's just your name would come up on the books that you would have to show your identification. And at that point, when you went in, you'd say, oh, you know, I made a displacement of the numbers. So I wouldn't know that that would be a illegal registration, if you will.
But isn't there a disclaimer on the bottom?
You're exactly right. It tells you in red, right, that if you are not a citizen, do not complete this form, and if you do, it's a felony offense.
Right. Okay. Make that clear.
So if someone knew someone not to be a legal resident, and they filled that form out, we could do a voter challenge. And that will be presented to my board and then to the district attorney's office.
Does that happen?
No. And Mr. Britt and I had a conversation with the general counsel at the State Board of Elections, and you know, it's been their, I guess, position, if you will, that a person that is not in the country legally is trying to fly under the radar. They're not going to do things to present themselves in a matter that would get themselves caught. So I don't think, in our personal opinions in the elections field, that is an issue. We've not heard that, you know, so far as of yet. But if it is a federal offense, it's a felony.
Mr. Bass, what's the health department stance currently on the use of work notes? And is it on the work notes?
Well, I would say we're in the process now of developing a policy that's going to be presented to the Board of Health tomorrow night, and that policy would have the individual name the names that they're known as, because we're trying to get to a primary name that would be that individual, because if we're having to follow up any kind of medical problem that the individual may have, we need to have a single name. So we're getting the names that they're known as, and we're asking the patient specifically, what do you go by? And that's the name that we're having in our medical record.
But the work name.
Sir?
The work name. If you're presented with a situation like what we're seeing tonight.
It would be the name of, who are you? Are you Tim Sutton? Then that's the name that's going to go down.
The name that's on their file.
Yes, sir.
Without aliases or agents?
We are going to ask them, what is the name that they're known as?
One name.
Correct. One single name. Hopefully that will remedy this situation. It's our best faith effort.
Other comments? Sheriff, you got anything else?
I think the sheriff's got some closing remarks.
Pleasant endeavor for the Alamance County Sheriff's Department to come in over other agencies. However, I hope we have learned something from this investigation and hope that you as a governing body will work to try to get some of these policies and procedures changed. First of all, I don't see why we can't, our department heads can't go to our county attorneys to get a ruling rather than go to UNC at Chapel Hill. Everybody knows what the reputation of UNC at Chapel Hill. I can guarantee I could call four law professors and get four different answers on anything. We need to bring these policies together where they're not conflicting, and people like Susan Osborne and her staff can do their job without messing up or think they're messing up. We also have seen a conflict of policy versus law. Everybody in this age, in this building knows that identity theft is a felony violation. But yet, we have government telling our people running these departments, hey, you can't report this felony. And that really puts a hard situation on our department heads. Secondly, I want you folks to think about the tax dollars. Are we providing services and assistance to all of the Alamance County citizens in need? Or are those persons who are in Ellsworth precluded by law taking away from our elderly tax-paying citizens and our needy children? This is something that you folks can do. You may not control the spending of the Board of Health here, but you certainly control the funding. And the programs that are not going to our needy citizens, we need to divert that money to look after the people here in Alamance County. Think of the enhanced services and additional citizens that could be helped with taxpayers' dollars that are being diverted and consumed even in the illegal immigrant population. Please do not think I am a hard-hearted individual. I am not. But my deputies go into these homes every single day where elderly cannot buy fuel oil for the wintertime for them, cannot buy foods for their kids. I think we need to look after our elderly taxpayer that has paid for years into the system to be able to get why they paid into the system. The employees, once again, of Alamance County Department of Social Services and Health Department deserve clear-cut guidelines in order to meet our citizens' medical and financial needs. And government has to do this. What has happened to our country, our state, and our county when a government employee cannot report a felony crime? What has happened? This is absurd and goes against the very moral fiber that our country was founded up on, the nation of laws. And it is a great nation. Yet some of our government officials wants me and other officers here in our nation to turn our back on violations of the law. And folks, I'm going to tell you something. I will not do it. I have not done it. And I'm not going to do it. If you want to come here illegally and live in this country, do not violate any laws. Because if you come into, and I've heard all kinds of things said tonight about 287 G's program, we do not go out on the streets and drag people off the street. The only way they get processed is to come in the Alamance County Jail under criminal charges. That's it. If I wanted to profile, as Commissioner Sharp said, I think the last meeting, I could fill 500 jails in this nation. But let me tell you something. I do not care if a person comes here and works his shirt, but I took a legal obligation to uphold the laws of this nation, folks. And I don't know what that means to you, but it means a lot to me because my hand went on the Holy Bible, and I took an oath of office. The ministers talked about God's law. Well, the Bible talks about man's law and God's law, and we should honor all of the law, man's and God. Gentlemen, I don't make the laws, ladies and gentlemen, but I'm asking for them, and I'm going to. I am going to. I know people say, well, you know, you're the sheriff, you got power to do this, power to do that. Let me tell you something. I hurt for every individual I've ever put in jail. I hurt for them. But they made the choice. I didn't. Why should I charge an American citizen with no operator's license or identity theft and not charge someone else? Why? I want you to tell me why. Somebody tell me why. Commissioner Sharp, it's not the sheriff's office out of control. It's our government who wants to bend the laws, make new policies to circumvent the laws to address a certain population in the name of political correctness. I have news for you and every citizen of this county. As long as I'm sheriff of this county, we will enforce all laws that are on the books, and if you want anything different, there's two things you can do. One, you folks that are here, and I disagree with some of the laws in this nation. I do. But if you want the laws changed, you don't need to be coming jumping on the sheriff or the commissioner. You need to go to Washington, D.C. or Raleigh, North Carolina. Because that is where it's broke. It's not broke with me. My hand went on the Bible. And I am not going to commit perjury to the Almighty God above. I'm not going to do it. The second thing is, if the citizens of this county does not want me to serve as sheriff, they can vote me out. But as long as I'm sheriff, I am going to do my job, commissioners, and the only thing that you can do is cut my budget. That's how strong I feel about my job. And Mr. Sheriff, I see you smile, and I think that's great, and I think it's fun. But let me tell you something. You are a government official, too, and have to put your hand on the Bible just like I do. And that don't mean we serve one segment of population and not the other. Another individual made a statement a minute ago about one group, taxpaying group. Well, we're all human beings, and I know that. And they ain't one taxpaying group if you're here in America. They're black, white, Hispanic, short, tall, fat, long, Chinese. And we're all equal in the eyes of God, and I know that. And I know that as a sheriff and as a citizen. And I frankly do not like the fact that you have gotten people stirred up by saying the sheriff's office profiles. Because I have shown... I
don't know if you do or not, Sheriff.
Well, I can tell you, I got it right here.
You're telling me you don't. I don't know that's true.
Well, Mr. Sharp,
you know, I think you're an honest man. Y'all giving your report. Now you're starting to editorialize.
No, sir, I'm trying to explain some of this stuff, too.
I think we heard the report. And I think your comments are just adding fuel to the fire instead of...
Well, all I ask is you as commissioner, if you have a problem with anything the Alamance County Sheriff's Office does, come and see me. You've never been in my office that I know of. Thanks.
Well,
Oh, the laws?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I will encourage you to seek out GS 153A103.
Okay.
And that has to do with nepotism, and that is in the county policy handbook. I did go through your handbook, your policy and procedure book.
Yes, ma'am.
I honestly could not find, if you can, and locate it for me, I could not find anything about leaving anyone in a vehicle while someone is being taken to grain.
Okay.
It happened several years ago and again now. I saw where the deputy has to secure the vehicle, secure the contents, et cetera, make sure everything is safe, but didn't talk about people.
Okay. Once again, as I said, if there is neglect and abuse of that child, we call social services. Other than that, we can't take those kids if that parent says, I want them left with John Doe here. We can't legally take that kid. So there don't need to be a policy governing that particular situation.
Madam, I disagree with you. I think you can to keep the children secure. Leaving them out is, I don't care what the parents
say. And they were not left out, Ms. Vaughn. Why don't you check with the highway patrol who has the car that runs the interstate? And that's all I'm going to say. There's a lot of things that has been reported falsely trying to disrupt the 287G program.
Well, I'm not attacking that, sir.
Well, I know that.
I was just concerned about the kids and people not doing it.
And I think that's why we're having some of the problems that we're having in these other departments that some of you folks think is a problem, is there's a lot of conflict in policy, procedure, law, and there's a lot of things that I don't have control of that I can and can't do as a sheriff. And one of those things is if a parent says, I don't want a child taken from me and there's no abuse and neglect, guess what? I can't take that child.
But if you leave the child, isn't that abuse and neglect?
If this man says, this is my church-going friend, I want my children left with him. Now, what's going to happen? No, you can't do that. I'm going to drag them children, put them in my patrol car. What's the newspaper going to say next day? And what's